After conception, a storm of biochemical processes takes place within and around the fertilized egg cell. These processes form the groundwork for the body that grows out of it.
Well, with the first cell divisions, a clump of cells forms which sits on top of the yolk. These cells then start to move over the yolk, forming a single layer of cells. When they're halfway down, they start to move inwards, forming a multi-layered structure. And this process is called gastrulation, which is very important.
Failures in gastrulation can result in severe or fatal birth deficiencies.
And as the famous developmental biologist Lewis Wolpert already said, it's not birth, marriage or death, but gastrulation, which is truly the most important time in your life. Well, all cell behavior can be traced back to biochemical reactions between cells and within cells. My biochemical background comes at hand when we try to figure out what chemical reactions lie behind the development of a body. In my group, we really look at this regulatory mechanism of proteins, which is protein phosphorylation and protein dephosphorylation.
So on a daily basis, I have to check my adult fish for tumor growth. Phosphorylation and dephosphorylation plays a crucial role in the cell, and it's linked to cell growth. So if you have a communication defect in this process, it may lead at the end to tumor growth and cancer.
Well, phosphorylation is like a molecular switch. Phosphorylation, or the addition of a phosphate group to a protein, may activate it. And then dephosphorylation, or removal of this phosphate group, then inactivates the protein again. Because if you can block specific phosphorylation events, you might have an important cancer remedy at hand. Well, dephosphorylation is actually very hard to study because you will first need to phosphorylate a protein before you can dephosphorylate it and study the dephosphorylation. We focus on the dephosphorylation and the enzymes that mediate dephosphorylation, and these enzymes are called protein tyrosine phosphatases.
I'm injecting RNA into zebrafish embryos, and we also use the knockdown method to study the role of phosphatases in early development. And with the knockdown method, we decrease the level of a certain enzyme and see what the effect is.
Well, we had a very interesting results with a particular protein tyrosine phosphatase, which is called SHP2 or SHP2. And we found that in zebrafish embryos that lack SHP2, these embryos show very similar phenotypes as what is seen in humans with a certain birth deficiency called Noonan syndrome and Leopard syndrome. Noonan syndrome is quite common. It occurs in 1 to 1,000 or 2,000 newborns. People with Noonan syndrome have heart defects, slight craniofacial defects, and short stature. Well, leopard patients initially are diagnosed as Noonan patients as well, and only later on in their life they start to develop these café au lait spots on their skin, and then they are diagnosed as leopard patients. And now the interesting thing is that both Noonan patients and leopard patients have mutations in the same enzyme, SHP2. But the Noonan patients have an activating mutation and the leopard patients have an inactivating mutation. So this is quite interesting that mutations in the same gene, one activating, one inactivating, induce very similar developmental disorders in zebrafish and similar symptoms in human patients as well. Well, several genes are known to be associated with Noonan and leopard syndrome, but still, in 25% of the cases of Noonan syndrome, the gene that is actually causing this syndrome is not known. So we want to figure out what the genes are that are responsible for this syndrome in these 25% of the cases. And we may have a very interesting candidate at hand already.